Valmiki. He chose a forest clearing near the river Ganga. He sat erect, closed his eyes, and began to recite the words the sage had asked him to. Mara, 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 Rama, Rama, he went on endlessly. As he did, incidents from his life flashed through his mind. He remembered his father and his mother and the endless trouble he had given them, and how finally one day his father had told him in anguish, Agni Sharma, it is best that you go to an ashram. There you will not get into fights and fisticuffs, and our villagers will have some respite. Your mother and I can do nothing more for you here. However, Agni Sharma found he was a misfit at the ashram too. The Vedas and the Upanishads did not impress him at all. He looked for ways and means to enliven his life there. And then he bumped into a group of thieves, and his life changed. These robbers lived in the heart of the forest, waylaying rich travelers and robbing them of their wealth. He liked their way of life, their freedom to roam, and the riches they enjoyed. Agni Sharma asked the robbers if he could join them. I can send some of what I robbed to my parents too, he thought. It will make life easier for them and make up for all the trouble I gave them. The chief of the robbers liked the young man's enthusiasm and welcomed him into their gang. You shall henceforth be called Ratnakar, the chief announced. Soon Ratnakar became a name to be feared far and near. He robbed and killed with ease, but always made sure he sent home a full half of his earnings. His parents were overjoyed. He has changed. He has finally become a hard-working, responsible young man, they said, and this is all part of his hard-earned money. Things, however, soon came to pass when he tried to rob a sage. Unperturbed at the terrifying spectacle of a Ratnakar brandishing a sword in front of him, the rishi asked him, Son, why are you doing this? Don't you know it is a sin to rob and kill? What good will it do you? I need to look after my family. I send most of what I steal home, Ratnakar replied. Oh, is that so? Please go home and ask them if they are happy to use the money got in such a sinful manner, asked the sage. Ask them if they are prepared to share in the burden of your sins too. I will wait for you here. If you don't trust me, tie me up to the tree till you return. So Ratnakar tied him up and went home. He asked his parents, If the money I send you is sinfully obtained, would you share the burden of my sins too? No, not at all, said his family. If it is sinfully earned, we don't want it, nor will we share the burden of your sins. We would rather live an honest life than partake of something sinful. A chastened Ratnakar went back to the sage, who was still tied to the tree. You were right, O Rishi. They refused to share the burden of my sins. I have sinned indeed, haven't I? My whole life has been one of sin. How do I repent? It's impossible. Nothing is impossible, Ratnakar, said the sage. I am Narad Muni, one of the Devarishis. If you do as I say, you will be able to shake off your past. Sit in penance and meditate on Lord Rama. Meditate? Scoffed Ratnakar dejectedly. I can't even say the name properly. All I can manage is Mara. All right, say Mara then. As you continue to repeat this word, you will gradually get the name right. Close your eyes and try it, ordered Narada. Ratnakar closed his eyes, sat erect, and began to murmur. Mara, 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 Ma, Rama, Rama, he went on endlessly. I will find you when it's time for your redemption, said the sage as he departed. Ratnakar, engrossed in his meditation, hardly heard him. And there he continued to sit unmoving and unaware of the passing years. Gradually, an anthill grew around him. It was a huge anthill. As time passed, nobody could remember when it had sprung up or how it had spread so high. Some old-timers remembered a sage meditating on the spot, but that was so long ago they couldn't really tell. 10 years passed, or maybe 20, or perhaps 25, when Narada Muni suddenly appeared. He immediately spotted the anthill. He began to break it down slowly, layer by layer. A faint Rama Rama could be heard, and the thin, wiry frame of Ratnakar emerged, eyes closed, completely absorbed in meditation. Ratnaka, cried Narada, shaking him awake. Ratnaka opened his eyes, stretched his arms and legs and looked at the world around him, a world that he hadn't seen for so long. A kind of peace he had never felt before filled his every pore. The Lord is very pleased with you, said Narada. Thanks to your untiring penance, you now have the powers of a Maharishi. You have been reborn out of an anthill. You will forever be known as Maharishi Valmiki, meaning anthill. Set up your ashram here by the river Ganga and continue to meditate and study the Vedas, advised Narada Muni. Valmiki did as directed and began to study and spread the Vedas he had once deplored. Soon his Gurukul became a place to go for anybody who needed any help or advice, and his fame as a learned rishi began to spread. King Dashratha of Ayodhya began to hold him in high esteem, and Valmiki was privy to everything that happened in the king's life as well as that of his son Rama. On their way to Vanavas or life in the forest, Rama and Sita even stopped by at his ashram to guest his blessings before continuing. Then after their return, when Sita was banished by Rama because of a washerman's remarks about her right to be queen, it was Valmiki's ashram that became her home. This was where her twin sons Lava and Kusha were born, and where they grew up and learnt the story of their parents' lives. In fact, it was Valmiki who introduced them to their father Rama when he appeared at the ashram in search of his horse that he had sent out for the great Ashwamedha horse sacrifice. In this animal sacrifice, a horse was released by ancient kings to wander for a year so that the rulers could prove their imperial sovereignty. And again, it was here that Rama was reunited with Sita after many years. Then when he was once again cast doubts on his wife's character, fed up and deeply hurt, she called out to her mother, Goddess Prithvi, to take her back. After this incident, Valmiki finally handed over the twins to Rama and said, my work is done. Take your sons back with you, Rama, and teach them how to rule wisely. After Rama and the boys left, life continued for Valmiki as before. That is, until the late Lord Brahma appeared. Valmiki, Lord Brahma said, no one knows the story of the lives of Rama and Sita better than you. Why don't you write it out for later generations to know? Valmiki was dumbfounded. The great Brahma was asking him to write the story of Rama. Thus was born the famous Valmiki Ramayana. It consists of 24,000 shlokas and 7 khandas or sections with about 480,000 words. As it was the very first epic poem of its kind in Sanskrit, Valmiki became known as the Adikavi, or the first Sanskrit poet the world has known.